Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh, and we are going to start with our daily current affairs. So today you have 12th of April 2021, and we are going to start with our class. So as you know, these classes are basically uploaded on the YouTube on the day-to-day basis. So you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube for your preparation. And for current affairs, there is huge weightage in the civil services examination. As you know, the UPSC has changed the orientation from the static questions to the current affairs based questions. For that purpose, you have to refer the national newspapers. For that purpose, you can refer the Hindu, which is a leading English newspaper, or you can also read Indian Express. Okay, both of these newspapers are equally good. You can refer any of these newspapers, right, for your current affairs. And you can also supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures, which are generally being uploaded on the YouTube on the day-to-day basis. Okay, so you can subscribe and you will get the daily current affairs based lectures. All right, so let's begin with the current affairs. All right. Okay, so first I'm talking about the Thwaites Glacier. Okay, this Thwaites Glacier is basically located in the Antarctica continent. As you know, the Antarctica, which is completely been frozen, right, which is located nearby your southern pole, or it is located in the southern hemisphere. Okay, now the researchers who is working with the University of Gothenburg, which is basically located in the Sweden, have found that the glacier called the Thwaites is basically melting, right? It is melting with much faster pace, right? As it is melting with that pace that it was previously anticipated or thought. Now, what happens is this melting of this glacier is occurring because of the supply of the warm water, okay? The supply of warm water, which is flowing underneath, right, with a very high rate, which was previously thought that it is not flowing with that pace and it is not affecting the glaciers. But now it has been found that the glacier is melting with a much faster pace. Okay, so regarding this Thwaites Glacier, it is located in the Antarctica continent, and it is around 120 kilometers wide, right? It is the broadest glacier, right? It is a fast moving glacier, and it is also melting very fast over the years. Okay, if you consider the size of this glacier, the size of this glacier is 1.9 lakh square kilometer. Okay, this is the size of the glacier, and it basically contains enough water. If this whole glacier melt, I'm talking about this Thwaites Glacier, it will increase the world sea surface level by more than 0.5 meter. So you can consider, just by melting of this glacier, right, which is having the area of 1.9 lakh square kilometer, there will be rise in the sea level by more than 0.5 meter. Now, the studies have published, or studies have found that, right, the ice which has been melting out, right, it will completely melt out, right, over the next 30 years, right? So ice flowing out of it would nearly double in the next 30 years, and it will be going to completely melt in the subsequent years. Okay. Regarding the contribution which is made by the Thwaites Glacier, the Thwaites melting contribute around 4% of the global sea level rise. For example, if there is 100% sea level rise, this Thwaites Glacier basically contribute to around 4% of the global sea level rise. Okay, now it would estimate that this whole amount of the Thwaites Glacier would completely melt or would completely collapse in around 200 to 900 years. It depends on the average temperature, which has been rising, right? Based on the pre-industrial level. So depending on the temperature, if there is a high rise of the temperature, obviously it will melt much faster pace, and it can melt in 200 years itself. And if the temperature is rising with somewhat moderate pace, it will melt in 900 years. Okay. Now, this Thwaites is important for the Antarctica, right? As it basically blocks, some sort of ice, or slows down the ice, which is freely coming out from this Antarctica, okay, to the oceans. So it basically blocks down, or retard the flow of the ice, which basically comes down to the ocean. Right. Now, what is happening is because of this melting itself of this Fritz Glacier, it poses a huge risk, right? And that is the reason it is also called the Doomsday Glacier. What is Doomsday? The Doomsday is nothing but it is an anticipated or a feared catastrophic event, right? Especially on the global scale. Why it is considered as a catastrophic or the anticipated event? Because once it completely melt, it will rise the or it will cause the global sea surface rise to around 0.5 meter. And you can consider if the 0.5 meter of the sea surface level is rising, what will happen? It will basically, you know, many of the coastal areas would be submerged, and it will affect especially the islands which are located in the world oceans. All right. So I was talking about this Fritz Glacier, which is located in the Antarctica, which is in the southern pole or in the southern hemisphere. So it is located specifically in the western Antarctica. So you can see this is what is a physical map. The one side you have the Indian Ocean, Atlantic Ocean, Pacific Ocean, because it is located all around your southern pole. So obviously all oceans also meet, right? Basically at the Antarctica continent. Okay, next. The lost golden city in the Egypt. Now it is basically, I was talking about a city which have been recently been discovered, right? Which are supposed to be lost. And this is the most important city with respect to, right? The city which is basically, you know, related to the king Tutankhamun tomb, which is basically around 100 years ago, right? So since the unearthing of this tomb, which is basically belongs to the king Tutankhamun, the discovery of this lost golden city in the Egypt would have the greater importance, not only for the tourist purpose, but also for, you know, for the preservation of the cultural aspect as well as the heritage aspect of the country. So here it is basically a 3 millennia old city, which is also considered as a lost golden city. Okay. And it is basically considered that an era of 18th century dynasty that is basically belongs to the King Amenhotep III, who basically ruled the country from 1391 to 1353 BC, was basically found in the southern province of Luxor, right? Which is basically having the country's best known monuments. Okay. Now, regarding Egypt, as you know, the Egypt is basically the most populous country in the Northern Africa. Okay. It is the most populous country in the Northern Africa, in the Middle East, as well as in the Arab world. Okay. And it is the third most populous country in the Africa. The first most populous country in the Africa, as you know, is Nigeria. The second is Ethiopia, and the third most populous country is basically your Egypt. And it is the 13th most populous country in the world also. All right. Then, as you know, that newly discovered city is basically located on the west bank of Nile River, okay, which is close to the Colossi of Memnon, the Medinet Habu, as well as the Ramesim, which is basically also called the mortuary temple of King Rama II. Right, all three are basically the most popular tourist destination. So the unearthing of this lost golden city would definitely boost the tourist destination. Now let us understand one by one what is this Colossi Memnon. So Colossi Memnons are basically the two massive stone statue of the Pharaoh Amenhotep III. So it is basically nothing but the two massive stone statues, okay, of the Pharaoh Amenhotep III, who was basically ruler and who basically reigned the Egypt during the 18th dynasty of Egypt. Okay, so I was talking about this Colossi of Memnon. The second is basically the temple of Rames III, which is also known as the Medinet Habu. This Medinet Habu is basically was basically the most important New Kingdom period temple architecture in the west bank of the Luxor in the Egypt. Okay, the Ramesim, which is a funerary temple of the Ramesses II, who basically ruled the country from 1779 to 13th BC, basically erected on the west bank of River Nile at the Thebes, specifically in the Upper Egypt. So these three, the Colossi of Memnon, the Merided Habu, as well as the Ramasin, which is also having the mortuary temple of King Ramses II, are basically the most important tourist destinations. Now, what we have discovered is that there are a lot of mud bricks houses have been found, artifacts have been found, the tools which were used during that, you know, civilization which have been found, right? Specifically of the reign of the Pharaoh, right? Even calling, you know, some call that in the ancient Egypt, Pompeii also. So you can see here, it is basically the lost golden city which has been discovered here, right, in the Egypt. Okay. Next, you have the Nora al-Matroshi. The Nora al-Matroshi is basically a female astronaut. It is a UAE or United Arab Emirates first woman astronaut, right? Which is basically named as the Nora al-Matroshi, right? So the United Arab Emirates would send the two astronauts, right, to the space program, right? And this is the first time the UAE has chosen the first woman astronaut whose name is the Nora al-Matroshi. So Nora al-Matroshi have been identified as the United Arab Emirates first woman astronaut that would be sent to the USA. Specifically, that will be, you know, with the male counterpart whose name is Muhammad al-Mullah. So both the Muhammad al-Mullah as well as the Nora al-Matroshi both will be sent to the NASA's Johnson Space Center, which is basically located at Houston in Texas. Okay, so both Muhammad al-Mullah as well as the Nora al-Matroshi would basically undergo the training at Johnson Space Center in Houston, Texas. All right, and if the Matroshi's ended up finally selection, right, on the mission, she would be the first from the Arab world, right, specifically to go to the space, right, from specifically from UAE. Okay, let's understand about UAE space program. About UAE space program, okay, first let's understand what is this UAE, United Arab Emirates. So United Arab Emirates is sometimes also called simply Emirates. Okay, it is basically a country in the Western Asia, and it is located on the eastern end of the Arabian Peninsula. All right, so let's understand about UAE space program. So first of all, the UAE also has started sending its, you know, the satellites to the different planets for the better, you know, research and the development. For example, in February 2021, the UAE has put its first satellite, which is also known as Amal, which is in the Arabic term, which is also known as Hope. So the UAE has put the Amal satellite or the Hope satellite in the orbit around the Mars, right? It is the first such satellite which have been sent to the Mars, right? And in 2024, the UAE also planning to send an unmanned spacecraft to the moon. So UAE also planning to send an unmanned spacecraft to the moon. And also here you must also understand the UAE also have the ambitious goal of building a human colony on the surface of the Mars by 2170. So it will take around more than, you know, around 97 years for the UAE to build a human colony on the surface of Mars. All right. So here you can see he's basically the Muhammad al-Mullah, and he's basically the Nora al, you know, who will be the first woman who will be sent to the space from UAE. So both of these will be sent to the Johnson Space Center, which is basically located at Houston in Texas. Okay. Next, you have the Leelavati Awards. Now you must understand these Leelavati Awards have been presented, okay, by the Union Minister of Education, Shri Ramesh Pokhriyal Nashik, right? He will be presenting the AICTE Leelavati Award 2020, specifically on the women empowerment, to the winners. Now, first of all, these awards have been awarded specifically for the purpose of the women empowerment in the country. Okay. And the women empowerment as the theme, which is basically also associated with this Leelavati Award. The objective of these awards are basically to create an awareness. Okay. The awareness creation, like the sanitation, hygiene, health, nutrition, literacy, employment, okay, related to the women technology, their involvement, credit availability, marketing, innovation, skill development specifically to the women, the natural resource endowment, the rights among the women. So this awards is basically presented for overall women empowerment, right? Specifically, you can say that the objective of this award to create an awareness, right, which is also related to the overall development of the woman, be it a hygiene, sanitation, health, nutrition, literacy, technology, credit availability, and so on. Okay. Now, the All India Council for the Technical Education has established this Leelavati Award. Now, let's understand what is this All India Council for Technical Education, which is in the short also known as AICT. So the All India Council for the Technical Education, which is also known as AICT, was set in November 1945, okay? It was set, and it was basically set as a national level apex advisory body to conduct a survey on the facilities which is available, right, for the technical education, as well as to promote the development in a country, right, in the country in a coordinated and integrated manner. So this All India Council for the Technical Education is a statutory body, right? And at a national level, council, right, for the technical education, and which comes under the Department of Higher Education under Government of India. Now, this award or Leelavati Awards basically covered the multidisciplinary areas, right? For example, the women health, the self-defense, sanitation, literacy, entrepreneurship, and the legal awareness to the women. Okay. And this program will ensure the participation of the women, and it will also enable them to hold the higher positions in the educational institutions. Okay. So it will basically enable, right, with the promotion of these type of awards to the women, it will enable further participation of the women, as well as it will also boost the participation of the women, specifically in the higher positions in the educational institutions. All right. So I was talking about this Leelavati Award, which has been awarded by the Union Education Minister. All right. Let's understand about Umgot River. So the Umgot River is basically flows through the Meghalaya, okay, which is a basically a state in the northeastern India. Now, the government of India is also planning to have a hydroelectric power project, which is 210 megawatt hydroelectric power project, which is going to set up on the Umgot River. Now, there are stiff resistance from at least 12 villages, right, in the Meghalaya state, right, which these villagers are basically protesting against this upcoming 210 megawatt hydroelectric power project on the Umgot River. Now, this Umgot River is considered as the India's cleanest river, right, clearest river. If you just move on the boat, you can easily see the bottom of the river. It is very clean river. Now, with the setting up of this hydroelectric project, what will happen? The area which is falling nearby, that will be inundated because you have to construct a dam, right? For that purpose, you have to acquire the area, and many villages also lost their area, okay? And it will also pollute to some extent the India's cleanest and clearest river, which is basically the Umgot River. So that is the reason the villagers of around 100 villages are basically protesting against such project. So this Umgot basically flows through the Davki. The Davki is nothing but a town in the West Jaintia Hill district of the Meghalaya. This river basically formed the natural boundary between the Ripanar, which is basically, on the Jaintia Hills, as well as the Himakaryam, which is basically located off the Khasi Hills. Now, a Davki bridge, which is basically, have constructed, right, over the Umgot River, is nothing but a suspension bridge, which is also flows through, or which is also, have been constructed across this Umgot River. All right. Now, let's understand briefly about this Umgot River. So I'll just give you a brief introduction about the Umgot River. So listen carefully. So Umgot River basically originated at the eastern part of the Khasi Hills, right, which is basically located in the Meghalaya state, right? Now, this river Davaki also flows, right, into the Bangladesh. And that is the reason it basically forms the natural boundary between the India and the Bangladesh. Now, the name of the river is Umgot, which is located at Davaki, which is also located in the West Jaintia Hills. Okay. So So what we say, a Dawaki village is basically constructed across the Umgot River, right? This Dawaki River is constructed in 1932 itself, right? It is constructed by the British itself, okay? And you can say that about a kilometer from the bridge, right, comes the Dawasi border crossing. And, you know, it is the Dawaki on the Indian side, and it is basically the Tamabil on the British side. So that means you can say that it is also makes the natural boundary between India and the Bangladesh, because around 1 kilometer from the bridge, you have the Dawaki border crossing. The Dawaki border crossing has the Dawaki on the Indian side, which is a town, as well as you have the Tamabil on the Bangladesh side. So that forms basically, you know, the main frontier areas. Okay. Now, the water of this Dawaki River, water of this, you know, Umgot River are so crystal clear that you can easily see the stones on the riverbed, right, which is distinctively visible. And you can also look, you know, from the road, right, that, you know, it has some sort of clarity on the river, right? So you can say that it is basically, you know, most wonderful river, specifically in the state of Meghalaya. And that is the reason the villagers are basically protesting against the river. Now, the villagers near the border of Bangladesh in the East Khasi Hills districts, right? You must understand, but the dam is basically proposed in the upstream side, which is basically located on the adjoining West Jaintia Hills. But still, the people, specifically from the 13 villages, are basically protesting against such, you know, project. Now, the project is executed by the Meghalaya Energy Corporation Limited. Okay, the people from the 13 villages along with Umgot are likely to lose around 296 hectares of the land, right? These 296 hectares of the land will be lost due to the submergence if the dams comes up for that purpose. Okay, so you can see here the boat, which is basically ferrying the four people, and you can see the bed, how clearly the bed is visible from the boat. Okay, next, begging, you know, the beggars, right? The beggars used to do the begging, right? So, you know, the Supreme Court has asked the center, a petition was filed basically, you know, in the Supreme Court, and regarding, you know, the, you know, some sort of a repeal of the provisions related to the criminalizing of this begging. So you have, first of all, the Bombay Prevention of Begging Act 1959, right? Which is a basically main statutory provision, which also criminalized the begging. Now, what is happening is that a plea has been filed, or a petition has been filed basically in the Supreme Court seeking to decriminalize this begging throughout India. Now, the plea has referred to August 2018 verdict of the Delhi High Court, right? The Delhi High Court basically also decriminalized this begging, but this decriminalizing of this begging has done in the National Capital Region, right? Now, this provision, which is related to the Bombay Prevention of Begging Act 1959, right, which treats the begging as an offense. And this treating of this begging as an offense does not sustain the constitutional scrutiny, right, because it is against some cardinal principles of the fundamental rights of the Constitution. And that is the reason a petition was filed seeking to decriminalize the begging process in India. Okay. Now, you can understand that the provisions of the statute, that is the Bombay Prevention of the Begging Act 1959, you know, criminalize the act of begging. But you can understand that if the people are very much poor, right, they have to make the choice. Either they commit the crime by doing begging, right, or don't commit the crime and just starve to death. You're getting my point? So either they do begging or commit the crime, or they don't do begging. That means they don't, you know, breach the law, but they starve to death. And in both of these processes, they are ultimately going to suffer. So it is against the very spirit of the Constitution, as well as it is also violates the Article 21, which is right to life. So the petitioner says that the very provision of criminalizing this begging in India is also against the Article 21 of the Constitution. Now, if you refer the census 2011 data, okay, the plea has, you know, basically the number of beggars. The number of beggars in India around 4,13,607 70 people or 70 numbers. Now, this number has increased from the last census. Okay, so you can say roughly around 4.13 lakh beggars are found in India. Okay, and in that purpose, if you consider that the people are basically, you know, around 4.13 lakh, and the government is failed to provide the social security to those people, and that is the reason they are resorted to the begging. Okay, so the constitution provided that, you know, in the directive principle of the state policy, the government is, you know, should provide the basic minimum facilities like food, water, roshan, right, you know, the house, and government is failed to provide the basic minimum, you know, necessity to the people, to the citizens of this country, which clearly shows that the government has failed to provide all such basic amenities. Now, the presence of the beggars is clearly evident that the state has failed to provide these basic facilities to all the citizens of this country. Okay, so here you can see the beggars is basically doing begging. Okay, next, the Iran nuclear program. As you know that the Iran is basically a country. Now, the Iran has, you know, has certain nuclear enrichment program, and with, you know, some agreement that is called the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, which is also commonly known as the Iran Nuclear Deal. So that is JCPOA, Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, which is also known as the Iran Agreement. Okay, so under Iran Agreement, the Iran has agreed that it will basically reduce its enrichment, you know, of the uranium, and it will stick to, you know, the comprehensive scrutiny across all its, you know, the nuclear plants. But now what is the news is that the Iran has started its, you know, the enrichment or uranium enrichment centrifuges, right, which is clearly says that it is simply breaching the undertaking which have taken by the Iran in the 2015 nuclear deal, which is also known as the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action. Now, the Iran is clearly breaching this deal, which is 2015 nuclear deal. And, you know, this deal, which have been breached by the Iran, is simply, you know, a breach of the trust, right, which have been made by the Iran. So let's understand about the JCPOA or Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action. So Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, which is also known as the Iran nuclear deal, or which is simply says that Iran deal. Now, it is basically an agreement, right, which is basically signed on the Iranian nuclear program, and this has reached in Vienna on 14th July 2015, right, and it has been signed between Iran and permanent five members of the United Nations Security Council plus the European Union. So it has been signed between Iran plus P5 members means the permanent five members of the United Nations Security Council plus European Union, EU. So that thing you can say that Iran plus P5 plus one, that is permanent five plus one is basically your European Union. So this has been signed between them. Now, the president of the Iran, which is also known as the Hassan Rouhani, inaugurated these cascades of 164 IR6 centrifuges as well as 30 IR5 and another 30 IR6 devices at the premier Iran's the nuclear enrichment facility, which is basically the Natanz uranium enrichment plant. Now, this is Iran's latest move to set up the uranium enrichment facilities, right? It will basically, you know, obviously in the following of the already opening of the talks, which has been there in the Vienna, which is basically in Austria's capital, where the representatives of the remaining parties will ultimately going to meet and going to discuss, right? And in the talks of the Vienna, right, the US, which have left this JCPOA or Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, is going to rejoin this deal. Because as you know that the previous president of the United States of America, Mr. Donald Trump, right, have basically left this deal, right, and claimed that or accused the Iran of, you know, secretly doing this enrichment of the uranium in certain nuclear facilities. So the Donald Trump has led the USA left the deal completely. But now the new president of the United States of America have decided to rejoin this deal, right? As soon as the Joe Biden basically assume the office as a president of United States of America to come back to the Iran nuclear deal. Okay, so here you can see the Tehran is the capital of Iran. You can see the famous nuclear facilities, that is, one is Natanz nuclear processing facilities of Iran. Okay, let's understand about Indus and the Ganges River dolphins. So Indus and the Ganges River dolphins are basically a species of dolphins. So first of all, let me give you a brief introduction about the river dolphins, right? So first of all, you have the common term that is called the South Asian river dolphin. Okay, the dolphin is a species of a fish. Now, the common term which is we use basically the South Asian river dolphin, because the Indus and the Ganges are basically the major South Asian river. So these rivers have some dolphin species that are called South Asian river dolphin. Now, this South Asian river dolphin is basically an endangered freshwater river species, right, which have been found in the region of Indian subcontinent, right? This South Asian river dolphin is split into the two species or two subspecies. The one is called Indus river dolphins and the second is called Ganges river dolphins. So first understand about Ganga's river dolphin. So Ganga river dolphin is basically officially discovered in 1801. So Ganga river dolphin officially discovered in 1801. Okay, the Ganga dolphins used to live in the Ganga, Brahmaputra, Meghna, as well as the Karnaphuli, Shangu river systems of the Nepal, India, and the Bangladesh, right? And now this species is extinct from most of the early distribution ranges. Now it has been, very limited stretch they have been found. Regarding Indus river dolphins, the Indus river dolphins are believed to have originated in the ancient Tethys Sea, right? Which have not been existed right now. So it has been existed in the ancient Tethys Sea, right? When this sea was dried completely around 50 million years ago, what happens is these dolphins are forced to adapt, right, to the remaining habitat, which is basically the Indus River. Today, you can find these dolphins in the lower parts of the Indus River, specifically in the Pakistan. And the river Bees also, and its tributary, has also this Indus River dolphins also. And you can also find, these dolphins in the Indus River in the Punjab also. So a detailed analysis of these South Asian river dolphins have revealed that, right, the Indus and the Ganga river dolphins are not one, but are the two separate species. Obviously, they are two separate species. And they are classified into two subspecies under the Patanstra gangetica, which is basically, a genus for them. And according to new species, right, the classification needs a revision. And it has been estimated that the Indus and the Ganga river dolphins may have diverged around 550,000 years ago. Regarding conservation status of the Ganga as well as, the Indus river dolphin, the Indus and the Ganga river dolphins are both classified as an endangered species, right, which is being classified by the International Union for the Conservation of Nature, which is also known as IUCN. Okay, the Ganga dolphin or Ganga river dolphin is basically classified in the Schedule 1 of the Indian Wildlife Protection Act 1972, right, under the animal category. And it has also been included in the Annexure 1 of the Convention on the International Trade in the Endangered Species, which is also known as CITES. Okay, so here you can see the beautiful dolphin, fishes. Next, the National Environmental Engineering and the Research Institute. Now, this is also called NERI. This is a premier research institute, right? The Council of the Scientific and the Industrial Research, which is also known as CSIR, have divested Mr. Rakesh Kumar, who was the director of the National Environmental Engineering and Research Institute, from the post of the director, right? This NERI is basically located in the Nagpur. Now, Mr. Rakesh Kumar, who was basically holding the post of director of NERI, have now been transferred to the headquarters, right, of the CSIR in Delhi after a certain allegations related to the corruption have surfaced against Mr. Rakesh Kumar. Now, regarding NERI, the NERI is established in 1958. It has the headquarters in Nagpur. Okay, and the NERI is basically a part of Council of Scientific and the Industrial Research, and ultimately it falls under the Union Ministry of science and technology. Okay, regarding functions of the NIRI. So first of all, the NIRI is basically a pioneer laboratory, specifically in the field of environmental sciences. Okay, and it has mainly focusing on certain research and the development on the water supply, sewage disposal, right, on the communicable diseases, as well as to the certain extent of the industrial pollution. Okay, and the NIRI is also the important partner organization, specifically in India's national implementation plan. Okay, and the NIRI is the institute which is operating a nationwide air quality monitoring network, which is basically, you know, operating this since 1978. And this program, which is also known as the Nationwide Air Quality Monitoring Network, this program is sponsored by the Central Pollution Control Bureau, Control Board. Okay, and the NIRI is also involved in basically, you know, the manufacturing of the green firecrackers or the technological development or behind all sort of a R&D behind the green firecrackers. These green firecrackers are compulsory, you know, as the directives given by the Honorable Supreme Court to improve the Delhi's air quality, right? Obviously, it has been specialized air purifier, right, which also have certain need in an indoor environment. So the NIRI has involved in the research and the development, in the technological development for the construction, for the manufacturing of these green firecrackers, as well as it is also involved in the specialized air purifiers also. Okay, next, terror financing. Terror financing is the process by which a person or an agency or an organization is involved the financing, right, to the certain terrorist organization. So that process is called terror financing. But the extortion money, that means, for example, a terrorist organization is there. If the terrorist organization threatened a particular, you know, agency or organization or a person to force to pay the terror organization a certain amount of money, that is called extortion money. Okay, that extortion money will not be considered as a terror financing or a terror funding, because that extortion money that is paid by the person out of compulsion, it has not been paid for the purpose of terror financing, but it has been paid for out of compulsion. It was the agency was forced to pay, right? And that the Supreme Court held that such type of extortion money will not be considered as a terror financing. Okay, why this news is there? Because a person was arrested, right, which is basically related to the Jharkhand coal transporter, who was basically paid the huge amount to the Tritiya Prastuti Committee, which is also a breakaway function of the banned organization, banned terrorist organization, that is called CPI Moist. So the person who belongs to the Jharkhand coal transportation have paid the huge amount of money to the Tritiya Prastuti Committee, which is basically also the faction of the CPI Moist. Now Supreme Court has granted bail to such Jharkhand coal transporter who have paid this money to such faction of the CPI Moist. Now the Financial Action Task Force on the Money Laundering, which is also known as FATF, is basically an intergovernmental organization. Okay, it has been found in 1989 on the initiatives of G7. G7 is a group of countries, belongs to the seven states or seven countries, right? Obviously, the purpose of FATF to develop the policies to combat the money laundering as well as this terror financing. Okay, now this Financial Action Task Force on the Money Laundering basically also made the recommendation to the members related to the counter-terrorism financing operations. Okay, now the Financial Action Task Force on the Money Laundering also created a blacklist or the gray list of the country. For example, Pakistan have been involved, have been put under this list, right? So the FATF have created this blacklist and the gray list, right? And it has, the countries have been put under this list if they have not taken adequate, right, steps for the prevention of this money laundering. Okay, and in 2001 also, the FATF have mandated to include the terrorist financing in this ambit. All right, so that's all for that today. Thank you very much for attending the session. We will meet tomorrow for our next session. Thank you very much.